In the United States, the number of new COVID-19 cases has been increasing almost every day. Schools and businesses around the country are closed, and many states have issued shelter-in-place orders. Adding to the burden is the uncertainty around how many people will be infected, when the epidemic will peak, and whether or not the community mitigation efforts, like school closures and business closures, are going to be necessary for months and months. The short answer is that some intervention will be necessary until at least half of the population either develops immunity through vaccination or develops immunity by contracting COVID-19 and recovering. The development of immunity in the population can happen rapidly or slowly, and this video will walk you through a tool for modeling the spread of COVID-19 and the effect of community mitigation efforts. That tool is an epidemiologic compartment model called a susceptible, infected, recovered model set up in Excel. First, we're going to talk about some of the ideas behind a compartment model. In a compartment model, the entire population is thought to be in compartments, susceptible, infected, or recovered. Movement between the compartments is a function of contact rate and transmissibility, that is from susceptible to infected, which really means infectious, and the duration of infectiousness, which determines movement from infected to recovered. Contact rate is probably the most important of these because it's the one that's under the greatest control. It's the number of susceptible people an infectious person contacts, and it reflects the mixing of the population. So what does a normal contact rate look like? The slide shows results from research done in 8 European countries among nearly 8,000 people who were asked to keep diaries about their contacts. And those included physical contacts, skin to skin, and non-physical, which is defined as a two-way conversation of more than 3 words in the physical presence of the other person. The average number of contacts was 13.4, and there was substantial variation by the different age groups. There was also variation between the 8 countries, and this slide shows you the number of COVID-19 cases per capita in those countries in the y-axis and their average contacts per day in the x-axis. Italy had the greatest number of contacts per day at 19.77, and Germany had the fewest, around 8. And it is correlated with the number of COVID-19 cases per capita that they have presently. The contact rate is the main target of the community mitigation efforts, like school and business closures. This graphic shows you data from the 1918 influenza epidemic and the variation in American cities. Some cities were quick to institute community mitigation and kept the community mitigation in place. St. Louis, for instance, avoided the spike in influenza deaths that is represented in the dark green by implementing school closures very quickly, whereas Philadelphia had a parade that brought together 200,000 people on September 28th. The blue X's that you see are the actual numbers of deaths per capita, and the dark green spikes represent what the number of deaths would have looked like had there been no community mitigation whatsoever. So you can see that St. Louis's community mitigation efforts were more successful than Philadelphia's. Just hearing about the number of deaths in 1918 probably reduced the number of contacts by about 20%, and community mitigation efforts reduce contacts even further, probably around 50 to 75%. The other important pieces of the model are the intrinsic transmissibility of the virus, although even that is under some control. When you're encouraged to wash your hands frequently or cough into your elbow, those are efforts aimed at decreasing the transmissibility of the virus, and the duration of infectiousness, which is the period of time an infected person can pass the infection. For COVID-19, that's probably around 10 days, although the number of days for quarantine, 14 days, reflects the amount of certainty needed that someone is not going to pass along the infection. These three factors, contact rate, transmissibility, and removal rate, which is the inverse of the duration of infectiousness, these three things, the product of them is the reproduction number, which is the number of secondary cases resulting from one case. So one person sick with COVID-19 produces some number of new cases of COVID-19. Right now, that looks to be around 2. And that has bearing for when no intervention will be necessary any longer. Because it means that about half of the population will need to develop immunity in some way. And that can happen either through vaccination or through infection. The inverse of the reproduction number is the proportion of the population that needs to develop immunity in order for self-sustaining transmission to be extinguished. SEER models have limitations. First is that they're closed systems. They don't account for people coming into the population, and they don't account for deaths either. Deaths are counted in that proportion that is the recovered, even if it's the case that they didn't. They're just no longer infectious after having moved from susceptible to infectious. So in this way, they're too simple. And there are researchers that produce much more sophisticated and accurate estimates of the size of the epidemic and when it's going to peak, such as the researchers at the Center for Global Infectious Disease Analysis at Imperial College London. That said, there are some advantages. Namely, it allows for easy modeling of the number infected, at least an estimate, the timing for the peak of the epidemic, and the effect of different social mitigation efforts like school and business closures. So that takes us to our model in Excel. And in this panel, you see the total number of the population who are susceptible, infected, and recovered. And here you see the impact on the healthcare system and mortality. Now, remember, the actual number of people who need to be hospitalized and needing ICU care is not a result of the susceptible, infected, recovered model. However, we know from data from the outbreak in China that 13.8% of people who had infections required hospitalization and 4.7% required ICU care. And we know that in the United States, among the number of active cases, the proportion of deaths per day has been about 0.9. So this model shows the movement in the compartments on a day-to-day basis for a period of a year, starting with the first case of COVID-19 in the United States on January 21st, 2020. You can change the model in two ways. One is to change the entirety of the model in the gold cells here. So, for instance, if you thought that the contact rate in the United States was not as high as the average that it was in the European countries. And you thought that it was 12 instead, entering a new value here produces this change in the timing and number of people infected. The other way to change the model is in a day-to-day way, right? So the school closures started around March 15th. So you might think that closing the schools would reduce the contact rate on average down to 6, let's say. So you can enter the new contact rate here, and let's say we keep the school and business closures in place until June 1st. So that'll be the new rate until June 1st. And you can see that it delayed the outbreak, right? So it could be that one strategy would be to keep those sorts of community mitigation efforts in place until a vaccine is available, and then have a vaccination campaign. And that would be a way of not having a sharp spike in the number of cases and overwhelming the healthcare system. You might not think that that is a sustainable strategy for such a long period of time. This model allows you to come up with alternative ways of getting to a point where about half of the population develops immunity, and this is done without producing an overwhelming impact on the healthcare system, because there are not 12 million hospital beds available. At most, there are probably 350,000, given the occupancy rate at baseline of hospitals. So this might be a strategy of keeping the contact rate low, but maybe not as low as 6 for a long period of time. It might be a strategy of keeping the contact rate super low for a shorter duration, and then loosening, and then putting restrictions back in place, and then loosening. Ultimately, whatever strategy is used should be one that reduces the number of deaths and reduces an overwhelming wave upon the healthcare system, because that will also produce higher mortality if people are needing ICU care and it's not available. The link to the model is posted. I hope that you will download it and implement some strategies for reducing the demand on the healthcare system and the number of deaths from COVID-19.